so much, Steffi. Thank you very much. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, friends and fellow travelers, many thanks to Hubert, to Steffi, to Marcel, to Christa, and everybody else. And of course, many thanks to our speakers. We're going to have short presentations by all the participants, and we'll then gather for a discussion, open it up to the floor. Also, last night I had a long conversation with Marissa Meyer from Google, and we're kind of inconsolable that the two panels happen at the same time, so we cannot attend each other's panel. So we thought it could be nice to connect, so she has emailed me the whole day questions for our panel, and we've emailed all our questions for the software panel upstairs. So for the first time, we try to connect these two panels, and that will then happen at the very end. Why art schools? Why Black Mountain College for the 21st century? It has all to do with many conversations which Rem Koolhaas and I have had over the last couple of years, which led more and more to this long-term idea that we would found and develop a new school, a new art and architecture school, an idea which we're now about to implement. And we felt it could be interesting here at DLD to raise this issue with some leading practitioners in art, architecture, of how they see how actually a new school for the 21st century could work. Whenever we had conversations, the Black Mountain College kept popping up, this idea of maybe a Black Mountain College for now, what could that be? What would John Dewey's ideas of art education mean now? The Black Mountain College had a limited lifespan and a very interdisciplinary approach. It created many, many unexpected connections of long-lasting influence. Teachers included Joseph and Andy Albers, John Cage, Robert Creeley, Merce Cunningham, William and Delaney Kooning, Buckminster Fuller, Walter Gropius. There have been lectures by Albert Einstein, William Carlos Williams, and alumni. The list is too long. Incredible artists from Robert Rauschenberg to John Chamberlain. One of the things which also popped up a lot was the idea that maybe it doesn't have to be big schools. I had a conversation once with the late Rudolf Arnheim, particularly I think interesting to talk about him here in Munich. He was telling me always about his friendship to Lovis Corinth, and he was saying that for him it was really all when he started in a small college that he learned everything about teaching, and when he later taught at big universities in Berlin and in Cambridge, he kept to trying to keep it in very small groups as it was at the beginning when he started actually to teach. So this idea of maybe small-scale models, there's also lots of unrealized models of schools, kind of pioneering schools of the 20th century we can maybe learn from. We think that new structures of knowledge are an important aspect of new emerging world systems. In the late 18th century, the divorce happened between science and philosophy. And as Immanuel Wallerstein says, what will change everything is to question it, to find a new and also unified epistemology, whereas the two cultures were for 150 or 200 years centrifugal. Actually now, complexity studies and also cultural studies are centripetal, which means moving actually towards each other. And that makes particularly interesting an unrealized model for a school, which I think resonates very strongly today, which is Cedric Price's Pottery's ThinkBelt, where the late Cedric Price had actually made research into simple architectural component that built a complex system, and it sort of reached really a peak, his whole work, in this unrealized Pottery's ThinkBelt, where he drew up not only the hardware, but also an entire program, a major project that had a lot to do with his discussions with cybernetician Gordon Pass, and where he tried to reuse an entire area of Northern Staffordshire actually by proposing a research facility which would be bell-shaped and which would go through a whole area by reactivating unused infrastructure. So it would use network of rail, motorways, really a classroom on the move with many research facilities. And this unrealized project of Cedric Price leads us right away to our first speaker tonight, Thomas Demand, one of the leading artists of our time who is actually not teaching in an art school, but who has had many ideas and actually one very big unrealized project of a school which was about ideological building, which he tried actually to realize for the Venice Biennale. We've asked all the participants to present a recent project, so Thomas will tell us here about the project he did for the New York Times on the 8th of November. Please join me in a very warm welcome to Thomas de Mann.
Thank you for having me. For the people which don't know me, I'm an artist, visual artist living in Berlin, and I'm working with mostly images. So this is an image which everybody in this room and probably everybody all over the globe has seen. It's the White House, and it's the new president of the White House. So I don't really exactly know where's my clicker. What do I have to do? Sorry about that. So if you look at this, this is like slightly the same, nearly the same image. It's just like lesser kind of amount of detail and looks a little bit more artificial. This is my image. This is my private appropriation of the image you saw before. And I have been commissioned to do that for the New York Times magazine for the main cover story, which was about the changes the office has been taken in the last 8 years in terms of, like, you know, the power shift to the vice president's office and the empowerment of the Senate. It was a rather abstract and academic piece, surprisingly enough to be in the New York Times magazine, and it was published in the first on the Sunday after the election. So it is, for me, it was rather a big surprise. They asked me like 4 weeks before publishing it. That they would ask a German artist to actually illustrate that that story. We kind of quickly agreed upon doing a reconstruction of the Oval Office as it is a well-known place. It's actually a place which everybody knows too well, in a sense, that you can do anything interesting with it, I thought, in the beginning. So nevertheless, what I'm doing now is I'm showing you, which I normally not do, I'm showing you the making of. I presented them a few sketches where I would like propose how I would picture the space alongside to the article taken. They agreed to give me everything and all the pictures they have in their archive to kind of work with, which kind of shortened up for me the whole process very much. By researching the pictures, you see that there's a certain typology appearing. So on the left-hand side, you see Kennedy, on the right-hand side, you see the former president. And looking at the body language of the person standing at the window, which, you know, it's an oval office, it's relatively small. You don't have that many possibilities to make a picture which looks like something. But, you know, looking already, again, you know, looking at the interior design, which slightly changes but keeps the same general structure. So you have the resolute desk in the middle. You have the picture desk behind there, which is mostly showing like some private items. Mostly, in most cases, it's picture frames. Then you have the curtains, and you have the flags, which kind of point out a certain symmetry. What is also not unmissable here is the posture and what the metaphor of the posture would look like in the left-hand thing, where somebody seems to look out into, you know, trying to solve the problems of the world, and right inside it looks like somebody was waiting for mom to come home. Anyway, so we have like, I was trying to distill from the masses of images some essence of what is actually to be seen. What I'm talking about now is I was doing a reconstruction of the Oval Office in life size, within 2.5 weeks, by the way, and we tried to kind of catch glimpses of all the presidency, as you know. So what I'm reconstructing is actually the Oval Office in your heads, and not the Oval Office standing in Washington. So I never went there. We never sent anyone there to find out. We just completely, entirely kind of tried to do this from the imagery we could get a hold of. You see, obviously, that we have different kind of images here. We have, like, on the top left is not from the Oval Office, it's Kissinger's office in Washington, where we will see in a second, where he was introducing somebody to world politics. You see the picture frame over there, which is in the center next to the telephone, which shows you an iconic image of the White House, which is not the resident desk, but is another one. And you will see in the close of the later images, you will see, for instance, you see that fireplace image that's top left is Obama's infomercial, 29 minutes long infomercial, like 3 weeks before the election, or 2 weeks before the election. You see West Wing, you obviously see that, you know, the Oval Office is not only a place to represent power, world power, but it's also has been virtualized in many, many corporations, in many, many films, TV series, and all that, and as cartoons. And you see where the real politics meet the fictional politics on the bottom right-hand side, where Al Gore instructs Martin Sheen how to behave behind the resolutions. So again, it's a drawing of mine, which is a proposed drawing of, like, you know, to get a sense of the whether that would be the right thing for them. We agreed relatively soon, as I said, to kind of not reconstruct Bush's office, but like have a kind of a generic idea of what of an office. Now we kind of got through all the four images, and now I'm coming to actually build the place. We built this entirely out of cardboard and a few wooden supports in the back. In the studio, as you can see, we just kind of were working on the curtains for like quite a long time until we got them in the right shape. And you know, the openness of the space is relatively important, obviously. But we built the whole entire thing. You can see how we translated, for instance, the bottom right image kind of shows you the single parts needed for the table for the picture desk. You know, like we use computer technology to kind of construct the oval shape of the wall claddings and the resident desk. But you know, that's what I'm just showing you that to give you an idea how the beauty of the process, in fact. So we did the flag on the real image, which you see again like in a second. The flag doesn't have any stars, as much as none of the pictures, you know, the books don't have any writing on it. Obviously, it's about the idea of the book. It's about the idea of the shield on the resident desk rather than the real thing. So I had to translate the carvings of that very famous and iconic desk into like three levels. But that's all what I do. Then all the images on the picture desk on behind, I just kind of made of silhouettes. Like, so you see Nixon in the office on the left hand side, and you see Barbara Bush and some, you know, like daughter Bush daughters on the thing. You see also that the book, which is laying there, is obviously not a book. It's a paper sculpture of like a thing which looks like immediately like a Bible because of the like two ingredients, the golden cutting on that side, the block and the red ribbon coming out. So we printed them in a magazine like this. This is the opener. You know, like accompanying the article. Those are finished images at a bigger scale. They were always intended for me to be in the end, like images on the wall, pictures on the wall. I also have to say that I have a kind of a history of doing that kind of process. And the biggest kind of challenge and the biggest promise of the whole process was that usually when I was working, like I worked with that kind of making images since 15 years, I usually would rip out pictures like you saw them before out of magazines and then reconstruct them as images, you know, which kind of slightly derived of detailing and you know, make me thinking about like I've seen this before, but I don't exactly know where to place it. I couldn't obviously employ that strategy on these ones because everybody will realize immediately where the pictures come from and what they mean. So I had to kind of actually tackle with the over visibility of the space. And so you see the fireplace, you see George Washington on the top. Another one is like when you see between the two picture frames on the back there, there's a third one, a third portrait lurking behind him. I worked like the previous year, I worked on a series about the Indonesia embassy in Rome, which has been the starting point for a rather long, lengthy but not unimportant conspiracy theory, or at least conspiracy plot, in fact, which ended up with Libygate and Blamegate before, because somebody broke into in the New Year's Eve of 2000-2001, somebody broke into that embassy in Rome, which nobody doesn't have any public hours or anything. It's the fourth poorest country in the world, Niger. And as you remember, later on, somebody stole empty stationery. So these are again the things. And now I'm coming to an end with the main image again. You see that the symmetry of the picture is slightly off. So the flag, the left flag is like a little bit towards the left, and the chair is kind of knitted in, and there's a light coming from the left. So I didn't want to kind of make it too clear in its own rhetorics. And another photograph through a door. And last week I showed the series in a place which actually looks, surprisingly enough, exactly like the same in Hamburg, in the Kunsthalle Hamburg. It's a show which is, where just, like basically the architecture found itself. It's perfect as the picture. Thank you very much. And, thank you very much. And,
great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Piero Golia, born in Naples, who is an artist now based in Los Angeles. His work has been shown in many shows. We worked with him with Gunnar Kwan and Daniel Birnbaum on the Uncharted States of America. In 2004, his feature film, Killer Frames, was selected for the Venice Film Festival. And it's in 2005 that he founded, with his longtime friend Eric Wesley, the Mountain School of Art. May I ask you to join in a very warm welcome to Piero Golia.
Sorry, the mic thing is very scary, but I've been trained to make it in 7 minutes to introduce everything. I'm going to talk about the school I started. I'm not sure if it's in 2005 or 2004, but I think in 2004 with Eric we came out to the idea of starting a school would be this lead by the idea of putting together different worlds. So created people with science, philosophy, and the business world, and law, and everything. So what we started off was this little website that now shrank back very small, but the idea was to create this page, which was a never-ending page made in Photoshop, and we would just keep on posting year after year what we were doing everything. We started the website, and in the first 2 months of the website I think we got 2 emails and wasn't very, but that was okay because we weren't prepared to have any student because we thought no one would never think to apply, and it wasn't until the day that we met Jorge Pardo was like telling us like you guys are starting a school, you have a space, that we realized we would need the space to do the school. And the first image that ran away was this room that they had in this bar in Chinatown, was the back room of the bar where we started the school. In the meantime, the letter, the emails from the website started to add up, and we realized that we had the spam filter, so we removed the spam filter and we started to get more and more email now that we didn't have the spam filter anymore. Then it came another problem that was like, since we were starting to get those applications, we needed to put together a program with follow-up what was the idea of the school we had. After months of files and everything, we decided to have a 3 months program out of the year for 12 students that we would find a way to select. And selection has never been something that... selection has never been something very easy in life because it's like it's very difficult to judge people, and in a way was going against the idea we had of putting things together, no? Because if you want to screen them, you don't allow teams to get together anymore. But at the end we find someone crazy enough to take over and do the selection part and choose 12 students to come every year. We take application from any kind of person who want to apply. We have mainly artists because it's like that's the pool for more easy for us to get people from. But in the years we had architect, we had musician, we had dancer, and our biggest success we got a biologist also. And we do a program who's 3 days a week in the bar from 6 to 9 in the night, because the bar opened at 6, so we can't go there before. After 9 o'clock, they are very busy, so they don't want us around anymore. So 2 days a week, we have the main classes, and so we have law, philosophy, science, art, architecture, and then we have another class called General Studies. We cover a little bit all the rest of the world. The only problem, we would still dream of having a bigger problem, but reality is a tough shit to deal with sometimes. No? We started the school with a series of 3 lectures, because when we started the school we still didn't had the chance to get steady students to come, and I think the first person who came, obviously all the first people who came, they were our friends who were trying, to come to talk, to make this thing happen real. So the first lecture we did was Franz Ackermann, who you will find in one of these pictures. And then step to step the school starts shaping, and we got the first 12 students, and in 2005 we start the first program at the Mountain School. The Mountain School name comes from the name of the bar, it's the Mountain Bar. There are a lot of, and then there is also the nice connection with the super good of Black Mountain College. Actually in the history there are also other beautiful experiences. And one of them was Nova Scotia in Canada, the school that Casper Koenig and then Graham. And that was also the reason why one of the people we really wanted to bring at the school was Dan Graham. And we took 2 years to finally get him to come to LA, considering that we had 0 budget. So we just hope that people get a show in town, or that they are powerful enough to buy the ticket themselves to come to talk at the school. We do offer free drinks for the speakers. This is Paul McCarthy. Actually, Paul and Richard Jackson are people we own a lot too, because Paul wanted to start a school, I think in Utah, where he's from, 30 years ago, but he never managed to do it. And I think for the guilt that he never started one of his own, he decided to help us and bring a lot of friends of his. The other day of the week, usually we go and we bring the students to visit people in their, either in their studio or either in their law office. We brought them a little bit everywhere, from Hollywood, their agency, to GPL, Caltech, Collection, Artist Studios. This is a project that we did at Art Basel in Miami, and the idea was to build this big tent on the beach so all the students who wanted to go to see the fair and couldn't afford an hotel could sleep in the tent. And it was a big failure because the fair people told us that they got the permit, and the day before they told us that they got the permit to build the tent, but not for having people sleeping inside. And that's Jorge, who designed the bar where we are in. This is Simon Forti. And the beauty of the school is this sort of legacy, when Dan came to talk, he told us that we should invite Simon, who was living in LA. And for example, when Hans-Ulrich came, he sent us to someone, And that's how the program is shaping step to step. Some of the students, the first year was just me and Eric doing everything. Now after 5 years, we have 20 and 25 people working. I mean, working is a big word considering that no one is paid, but doing, I got lost. 25 people, so at the end, nowadays, Eric and I, we just take care of the shitty job, like answering to emails and calling people, but we have a sort of steady faculty and steady people who take care of the application, student selection, program, and scheduling classes. Our science classes lead from those guys from GPL who are very nice, and they invite all their friends to speak about the scene. That was the law class, and I think practically my 7 minutes are gone, and I think that was more or less a very fast idea of what we do. It takes 7 minutes to tell, but I promise it's really big trouble to make it survive. We also offer free housing for the student. We have 12 students, 6 American and 6 from Europe. The 6 from Europe, we offer them free housing. And a little advertising, there is this person called Doug Ring who offers us a free apartment for the students to stay. So, thank you.
Now, the great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Carsten Höller, born in Brussels, lives and works in Stockholm. Some of his many exhibitions include Tate Modern, more recently, Bregenz and the Guggenheim Museum in New York. Particularly excited that Carsten is here because actually everything in relation to Steffi mentioned before, the Academy of the Third Millennium and Kistama. It all started with Carsten, and when we did with Ernst Pöppel, Art and Brain, which in 1995 was a conference in Jülich where we brought artists and scientists together. And the conference got cancelled last minute. We cancelled it, and we just made the event as a coffee break, where many things have happened. Carsten will tell us today about his most recent project, the Double Club. A very warm welcome to Carsten Höller. Same two. to amounts of floor space and time space. And these two units that are set next to each other without trying in any way to make them into one thing, so there's no attempt at fusion at all, is a Congolese reality and a Western reality. The project before was supposed to be called the Carter Congo Club, then we had to change the name because of the recent problems in the Congo, and it's then mutated into the Double Club. And it is like this that we have these three spaces all divided into a Congolese section and a Western section. It's slightly confusing for me that I don't have any images right now. Wie machen wir das? Das hatte ich vorher gesagt, dass die irgendwie zu groß sind, müssen runtergebracht werden. I'm sorry for the technical problem, so I have to restructure my talk and forget about this now, and I just look at the images and talk about it with you. So as I said, it has three different spaces, a bar, discotheque, and a restaurant. These spaces are all divided. The bar space is divided into two Congolese sections and two Western sections. Here you see what you see when you enter the bar space. You see on the left-hand side the tiles, a Western space, then a Congolese space, then a Western space again, and a Congolese space. The two bars in the middle are standing back to back to each other, and it's very neatly divided by straight lines going through the whole space, which are really virtual lines, which are there to keep the two parts as much apart from each other as at all possible. Here you have a detail of the tiles, which are actually representing a drawing from a Russian architect, his name is Georgi Krutikov from 1928, when he was designing flying cities, on purpose forgetting about the idea how this could possibly work, to make a city fly, but based on the idea that if you would live and work in the flying city, you could use the earth just for recreational and social purposes. And it's a whole design that we used as a basis for the work of these tiles and reproduced it as a very good representation of a typically Western utopian idea. This is a look from the restaurant into the bar space. The restaurant is divided like a chessboard, so you always have a Congolese square and a Western square. The Western squares are recognized by the Parisian-style brasserie tiles. The Congolese squares have a wooden floor. We have very similar structure, but everything is made differently. So we have plastic chairs, but they're of different quality, and also the tables are of a very different quality. The Western tables have been designed by Kram and Weishaar, and are the very elaborate design, the Western design, so-called breeding tables. The Congolese tables are comparatively functional and not really as design-based as the restaurants. You also see that in the restaurant there is an exhibition, in an exhibition, if you like to see this whole project as an art project. So we have artworks on the walls, everything from, on the left-hand side, Ole Bertling, then Sherry Samba, Carla Cardi, Andy Warhol, and Louis Nevelson. And the Ole Bertling painting on the left-hand side was especially important for me because it is a representation of how we divided the space in the bar. It's another view of the restaurant before the guests are coming. Here again. And then the third space is the discotheque. The discotheque is also divided, this time only in two parts, but the division is much less obvious than in the other spaces. So you have like a line going through which has mainly to do with the finish of the wall and the floor. You see this line in exactly the middle of the picture if you follow the ceiling. And centrally located in this discotheque is a dance floor where the DJ is on the dance floor. And the DJ is turning on the dance floor at a very slow speed. So the whole dance floor is turning, and also the rig in front of the dance floor. And while the DJ is in the Congolese part of the room, he or she plays Congolese music, and then it very, very slowly turns into the other part of the room, and the DJ is playing Western music. So also the music is divided in time. The whole thing is divided in space, but also divided in time, so that you have Congolese and Western music alternating each other. This was an experiment which has never been done before to see how these two things work together. And it's actually quite tricky because DJs are building up in the course of an evening to get people more and more into a special mood, if you want to call it like this. So we had to, we had some problems really with that. It didn't work in the way that I thought it would work. We're still keeping it on Wednesdays and Thursdays, but we decided to make Fridays in the discotheque only Western nights, when then playing Congolese music in the courtyard, and to make Saturdays only Congolese nights with concerts and everything, and playing Western music in the courtyard. A few more images of this whole space, and then I would like to, you see people in it after we opened the restaurant, discotheque. I would just quickly like to go to the questions that I'm always asked about this project. They're very similar. I've been given a few interviews to make it known enough that people are coming. And the first question they always ask me is, why Congolese? Well, first of all, this is not Congolese, it is Western and Congolese. It is very neatly divided into these two parts. But it is also based on several basic ideas that I think are strong enough to justify this opposition, you can almost say, or juxtaposition of Congolese and Western culture. You know that the Democratic Republic of Congo is of similar size than whole Western Europe. So already these two territories, if you want to call it like this, have similar sizes. But mainly, I was very interested in the fact that Congolese music is a very well-known and incredibly strong phenomenon on the African continent, but it's a kind of music that is almost never heard in the Western world. It just doesn't appear. It's not in our radio programs. It's just not there for reasons that have to be discussed at some other place. So the music, the importance of the Congolese music that I honestly believe in was one reason for me to choose the Congo and not some other place in the world as something to be juxtaposed to the Western world. But then there's also this Congo thing that is going on in our Western heads. It is, the Double Club is a place which is happening in London, in a Western city, and Congo has a very strong elicitor function, which is interesting enough to have a closer look at it. This third Congo, if you want to call it like this, is a country that is only existing in our heads. It's the dark continent which is left behind by progress. It's the heart of darkness, it's the horror, And it is also, in the sense of Nicolas Merzoyev, the Congo as a trans-cultural double club. The Congo as a country which already has these two identities due to its history, and then being a very good representation of what this is all about. But maybe I can say the Congolese is absolutely not important at all in this project, because it could be anything else. This project is very much about juxtaposition, about double identity, of having a situation where not one decision is taken in front of one thing, but where it's all about putting two things together and see how they behave next to each other, and how it is affecting a social environment where you're meeting somebody and possibly this other person is just sitting in front of you, and you see the person with a Congolese background and the person sees you with a Western background. I'm also often asked if it's an art installation, and I think it is half and half. It's half art, it has all the elements of art up to a certain point before they get too dirty and mingled up in some kind of restaurant, bar, discotheque experience. So it is not pure art anymore. It's not about representational art that you bring to the museum or to the gallery and hang on the clean white walls. It's about some kind of dirty art which still has the strong art ideas in it, but brings it into another context which can be experienced differently than by pure representation. And then the last question, which is one which I'm mostly asking to myself, is about the nature of amusement. This place is about getting people amused by food, by drinking, by talking to each other, by dancing as maybe the most obvious form. And I believe in the eeriness and the very strong influence of amusement as something completely ununderstood, something that almost like a parasite, or like a dictator if you want, without it being too negative, is dominating our lives in a very strong way. And I just think amusement is something I want to look at from this perspective in a more close way, and want to understand its nature better. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Carsten Hörner. I've got now the great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Maya Hoffmann, who is a Swiss collector and actually producer of a very, very broad range of projects, including art, publications, films, and also many environmental initiatives. In 2004, Maya founded the Luma Foundation and has since then produced a lot of reality, many art projects, collaborations with the Center for Curatorial Studies at Bar, as well as the New Museum and many, many other places. More recently, Maya has launched a large-scale project, the Bach des Ateliers in Arles, a very transdisciplinary project which at the core has a campus, has a school, has an archive, has a garden, has an exhibition space. And she will present this project to us here today. A very warm welcome to Maya Hoffmann.
This is, yes, good evening. This is the statement, the mission statement of the Luma Foundation, and I'm going to present so far where we have, where we are standing with our project of the Bach des Ateliers. I'm starting to read and then I'll be more free. The Bach des Ateliers now is a model and a master plan for a new type of cultural utopia. This is the city of Arles. Imagined, invented, and designed as the ultimate destination by artists, architects, art professionals, and intellectuals in accordance with local inhabitants who have an intimate knowledge of the town of Arles, it is an open campus for creative production, display, study, and preservation. Photography and the moving image are its central force, and innovative research and exchange are its ongoing mission. Aligned with the mission and the aim of the Luma Foundation, the Parc des Ateliers unites culture, education, and the environment. It encourages a fruitful dialogue between disciplines and visions, rich in contrast as vital elements of a forward-looking society. With the Parc des Ateliers now, we would like to create a new model, so we are just at the beginning of it, as you understood, which will include archives and residencies at the same time. It is in the middle of a bigger complex and in the center of the city. This is the aerial view of this place. But before I start really with the presentation, I want to explain how we really are working right now. We have created a whole group of people with whom we are meeting on a regular basis, and we invite specialists and great thinkers to join the meetings depending on the topic, but not on a permanent basis. So we have a core group, we have guest specialists, and the system stays alive and renewable, but at the same time, it will be stable with the core group for the years to come, because this is there to stay. So back to the project, this is a maquette, a model of the master plan represented. The city of Arles is in the delta of the Rhône River, like you saw before, between Avignon and Marseille. All the other cities around developed much more, but Arles stayed more or less undeveloped. There is a vast area which has been excluded from the city by a huge wall around, and bought by the SNCF, like you saw before, and it has been closed in the 80s. But before that, it was bought by the SNCF, which is the French National Railway, and they were building trains there, and they employed up to 3,000 people. Now it's been closed since the 80s. Since its closure, we opened the space from time to time for a festival in summer, which is the International Festival for Photography, which is called the Rencontre d'Arles. So we opened the buildings little by little and organized large-scale shows with more and more people coming to visit. This has been like open for the five next years, and people visit more and more. And then after we saw that people wanted to visit, we tried to federate all the different energies in town. For instance, there's a publisher, which is called Actes Sud. There is the whole region of PACA, it's Provence, Alpes, Côte d'Azur, and the city council of the city of Arles. There's also the only school of photography, which is the only national school of photography in France. Let me see this. We started creating a master plan, and we asked Frank Gehry to get involved with the overall planning. We were looking on the plan for about 6 months last year. I made a presentation of our work in progress to the public in July 08. I'm going to make that a little shorter now. So the thing is, we don't want to put all these things into volume and shapes right now, as you saw in this, but we actually are at the point where we prefer to think about the things like, let me see where we are now. Did you have time to read the slide? This got mixed up, actually. These are the facts. So let's go back to the facts, and I think we will be able to catch up. I'm not able to read that. The Parc des Ateliers is going to be developed as a multipurpose structural park within the cityscape. It intends to create a campus and recreational garden in the city center, providing the infrastructure for other various activities. And and the display creation, study and preservation of photography and moving image will be at the heart of the project. So what happens in the meantime? There is also another part of the Parc des Ateliers, and it means to reinvent the garden. There was a former park, a former jardin d'hiver, but it's not existing anymore. And this is meant also to be for the people and the visitors and the local population and the students to come and hang instead of only work. So this place is going to put together different activities. In the meantime, and this is why I came here today, because as you see, we are not ready now. In the meantime, before we start the building, we have been speaking and organizing the think tanks. And this is really what it's all about today. We want to think the place instead of having the design or the architecture decide and maybe putting as a result the things into too formal already and not open enough. So we actually want to take all the elements which we have and try to put them into, we are going to look into what the needs are for this town, at the same time what the needs are from our coming out from our think tanks in terms of education, in terms of archive, and in terms of residency before we really start with the design. So there is a very long time to go. Andrew Santos, a professor at Columbia and a participant to our think tank, said architecture has this way of maybe sometimes getting things into straitjackets. So these are the think tanks format. What we really have been considering is what are specific sites for exhibition, archives, residences, meeting places, workplaces, organized and informed structures for education, and food and entertainment. This is important too, because it's going to be an open campus. We are looking for what the DNA of this project will be, what the structure, how does this get expressed? Is it expressed in the architecture or more in the creative process or in both, which I think it's going to be in both? There are links to the surrounding community, very important in our, because we have very different people who want different things. And how private and how public should the site be? What about its access? How selective should the team building process be? And who will decide? What about the social impact of such a site in the community, and how can its integration be a success today, but also in the future? Quite ambitious, as you see. Now, this is the way the place looks like. There are some buildings we are going to keep, and the Luma Foundation is going to acquire some of these buildings. We have the overview plan here of the Parc des Ateliers, as you see, and this is referring to the slide we saw before. We have a big, we have some new building and some old buildings. This number 13 is referring to the building that Frank Gehry is now starting to develop. Actually, I'm going to see him next week, I think. Yeah. No, his partners, and then travel to LA to start the process again. This is the master plan we presented with him as of the end of 2008. So these numbers are referring to the slide before. I'm not going to go through all of this, but anybody who is interested can come and ask me later. Some other facts. This is the size of the ZAC. The ZAC is the zone which we are working on, and the program site. So all the middle part here will be this part in yellow, I think. Does it come out in yellow? Is the cultural hotels because it doesn't exist there. Of course, there are some partners on this, and we are just trying just to tell. The brown part, number two, being a station, a new station to create. The number 10 being the National School for Photography, so they are all different. The important point being that this is all in one garden, and instead of the walls, all the walls will be open, the access will be done. And on the other side, on the top, there is actually a university, part of the university, externalized university from Aix-Marseille, which are already underway and which will be underway before we come. So we were like trying to see in these think tanks, and we have a quote by Hans-Ulrich saying that actually this is also the fact, the talk we are having here tonight. There is, it's interesting really that there are no existing models that can be used. I think we are going to talk about this much more later. And what we really would like to do in Arles is to produce or help to produce this new generation, and I'm getting heaps of letters of people who could really go as far. This might be too much at this time of the day. When I was looking at this, it was at 10 this morning. This can still, these are the ways we have been looking at, which is like the first results of also what we've been thinking. I have been considering some models like this, the teaching around collection, and it's existing at the CCS Bard College, or teaching around the archive model, and this we are also exploring right now, and teaching around the residency, which I believe is going to be really a big incentive if we can at the same time also produce things, and not only if the artist can stay and then try to integrate this as a teaching process. We could organize symposia, public interviews, and the best technology. This, I thought, is great, what Andres said here. So we have three metaphors about what residency is. I think this is great, that's why I put it down here. So right now, we really believe that keeping on thinking in the think tanks with the core group, and maybe having this core group also impact, the core group inviting some people and trying then to install it in Arles will be good. It's going to take years, and that's why we are already working without having the building. Thank you very much, and if somebody has some ideas, I'm really interested in hearing more. Thanks.
bubbles, ever greater acceleration. A number of fundamental changes have taken place, and those changes create conditions in architecture, in cities, and in society that we simply didn't know. And because we didn't know it, it became important to find a device and to find a way of thinking about it, and particularly to teach about it. I was really lucky because I was asked by Harvard to become a professor, and I said yes on condition that I did not have any connection to design. The only thing I asked Harvard is to give me every year 12 graduates that I could make do whatever I wanted. Was that I didn't have to select. I agree with you that selection is a huge problem, but that I was simply typecasting in the sense that if we wanted to look at China, we would choose Chinese speakers. If we wanted to look at the residual influence of this party, we would select Russians with an experience of communism. In other words, we didn't necessarily select students on their qualities, but on their experience. And I think that this was perhaps the most, I don't want to say unique, but the most original part of the whole effort, i.e. to consider students as people who embody specific knowledge, and particularly at this moment, knowledge that may be superior to the knowledge of the teacher. And in basically creating a kind of common level, and in basically no longer insisting on the traditional relationship between teacher and student, the teacher who has knowledge, who distributes more or less well and with more or less generosity to the students, we were basically declaring ourselves perplexed in front of the current reality, and determined to find ways to talk about that reality and to analyze that reality. I would say that what we did was a kind of very political project, although I never get a lot of credit for being politically interested, and also because our interest in the Yes regime was very often explained as a kind of sympathy for it, and eagerness to align ourselves with it. I still would say that what we developed over time is a series of tools that enables you to kind of simply find an access to new phenomena. Without further ado, for instance, it has never happened, images like this one, where a rice field is in the proximity of a skyscraper. And this happens just north of Hong Kong in the Pearl River Delta. And so, because it never happened, our ideology, but also our knowledge, doesn't have any words for it. And that has been perhaps one of the most critical aspects of the Yes regime, that we could never enjoy and never enter any of its production, simply from the traditional values of the profession of architecture. We were forced to reject this and kind of forced to say that this is wrong, and it became increasingly apparent that the kind of vocabulary that we carry with us and the values that we carry with us are unable to capture or begin to discuss this kind of image. And so what we wanted to do is kind of simply develop the tools to discuss this kind of image. This is another of this kind of image, a city that grows so incredibly fast. All of the substance that you see here was generated in 10 years, that it is forced to leave everything that would be slightly complicated, like a mountain, alone. So it can only grow on the flat parts, it can only grow where it is simple, and therefore it surrounds whatever is kind of more or less complex, another kind of city that we've never seen before. And if you also look at the parallel digital reality that was generated parallel to this kind of metaphorically, but also probably practically, digital tools like Photoshop. And Photoshop can be kind of simply defined as simply taking whatever you like and kind of inserting it in a single picture and then kind of generating an image that has a kind of plausible degree of reality. What we theorize is that kind of Photoshop is now underlying a lot of architectural production and a lot of the production of cities, and that therefore it's no surprise that in this center of Shenzhen, the dark densest point of a city, which in the meantime has reached 50 million people, it is only 400 meters away from rice fields, and that this kind of contrast that simply never has existed before is simply evidence that the world of cities is now kind of being produced according to values and with methods we've never seen before, and importantly, from which the architecture profession is itself very distant. So, since we were architects and since we wanted to understand and perhaps potentially to find some kind of relationship, we analyzed then what kind of architects and what kind of thinking produces this kind of city. And for that, we simply analyzed first how many architects there were in China. And these are the number of architects per 1,000 people. And we discovered that England is very blessed, France is blessed, Europe in general is blessed, America has only half as few, many architects, and China has almost no architects per 1,000 people. We then looked at kind of honorariums of architects, and then we discovered that, again, European architects earn a lot, and that the Chinese architect earns less than his colleagues. And then we looked at how much the Chinese architect on average built, and we discovered that the European architects, many as they are, and a lot as they earn, built almost nothing every year. The American architects built a lot, and the Chinese architects built at least 100 times the volume. So what we discovered, and I think this was the virtue of the method, was that actually there is a way of understanding this city. There is a way of understanding the kind of acceleration which is necessary to for each object to produce this kind of amount of substance every year. And what I also would argue is that all these facts together, of course, offer the ingredients of what eventually could be seen as a kind of political critique. We also were very careful to try to find the words for these phenomena, because we really literally discovered that there are no words, and partly we used kind of existing words, but partly we also kind of simply gave new definitions to existing words. For instance, corruption. Corruption, one of the obsession of Western civilization, one of the tools with which the West has always been belittling and humiliating other societies, telling them how corrupt they are. Clearly, corruption in many societies is kind of simply the necessary adjustments between reality and the norms. And of course, after the now that we are witnessing the end of the Yes regime, we can also see that corruption was perhaps nowhere as endemic as it was in the West itself, so that it was only clearly unmasked really as a tool. I want to spoke 7 minutes, so I'll end now, because this is kind of really what I have to say about the method. I suggest that we meet as a group.
Thanks so much, Ryan. Thanks, all of you. art world, we observe that less and less artists we work with are actually teaching. Most recently, I've had a conversation with Michael Craig Martin, who has been instrumental to kind of put England on the map with his extraordinary teaching activity at Goldsmith. And he said, given the state of art schools in England now, he'd never ever teach again if that would be the case today. I mean, Thomas and Carsten, you both have not really been teaching a lot in art schools as well. And I was going to start actually by asking Thomas to tell us about your project for a temporary art school, which remained unrealized in Venice.
So, first of all, I want to point out that if you know if we focus too much on the art school, it might look a little bit specialist kind of discussion. But we should keep in mind that the art school in, and there have been researchers in British art schools which have had to justify their budget all the time against the you know the Thatcher cutting money away from the educational purposes. That the art school usually is one of the last remaining general studies where like you know like the apparently even over 90% of the people which have ever been at an art school are working in the arts afterwards, and the arts not being just becoming a painter, but going to, I think even like YouTube, I read today in a book that the founder of YouTube, Chad, has a BA in fine arts. So you have people from the fine arts going everywhere, going into visual culture, going into shaping the face of society in a sense. So if you kind of, you know, loosen up a little bit the arts as just not being only in the art market and in the white cube, then you have actually a very influential platform for, you know, forming a mind or forming like any influential elements into culture. The project we were proposing for the architectural Biennale, the last one in Venice, was a project which with two friends of mine, both architects, we wanted to do something like a seminar instead of like having a show with pedestals and models on top, which usually is more or less the shape of a show in you know showing architecture. We wanted to kind of set it up for 120 participants over the course of the 8 weeks of the 10 weeks of the Venice Biennale, maybe like a few weeks beforehand. And we wanted to do that about the topic how ideology gets into architecture. And ideology doesn't mean political or ideology only, but like we heard today, for instance, about ecological building, that is clearly an ideology. It's probably one we like very much today, but like of course it's a democratic building. What is a democratic? What is democracy to do with building and architecture? What is the presumption of like glass being in architecture as being democratic or transparent? You know, like what is the metaphor to kind of impact all these things? And we wanted to discuss it with only like a key group of participants which would just like leave school and maybe be like the first 3 or 4 years in architectural offices as you know like being architects but not self-employed yet, because we thought like that would be the group which can, you know would profit the most from a kind of a network. So if you imagine we would have somebody from North Korea talking about ideology and architecture and how you know ideas get into built realities, and maybe somebody from Chile who does it you know like in a completely different way, and we hope that out of maybe the 120 participants we would have like maybe 40 or 50 which would stay in contact somehow or the other, and they would have never met otherwise than through this platform. And the public would only be sidelined, and they would like, you know, be able to look at it from the outside, but like the whole purpose of the undertaking would have been you know, a public display of any kind. So that was the idea. They didn't like it very much. There is a, you know, it lacks actually public display, so therefore there's no, you know, the minister can't hold a speech for the opening and like all these kind of little things. And also maybe the other proposal was better, so we didn't realize.
Carsten, I wanted to ask you, because we've had so many meetings in terms of new ways of knowledge from art and brain to bridge the gap to many other strange encounters. However, you always told me that you're not really interested in this idea of teaching in the human art school. So I was wondering how an art school, or not an art school maybe, but a more transdisciplinary school, how a new black market college would have to work so that for you it would be an incentive to participate.
But in all the others, no. Definitely, maybe I should say why I would in principle criticize the idea of the art school as it exists mainly in Europe today, from what I've seen. I understand it works quite differently in the United States, but this whole idea of training somebody to become an artist is a paradox. It is not something that can be taught. trying to learn how to make a show in a place, but it should be about bringing the interested people the amount of information that can be really transferred, which is history, theory, and of course you can speak about writer things like ideas and these kind of things. I come from a very different school training, if you want to call it like this. I studied agricultural sciences. That is something that can really be transmitted in a school context, in a university context. It's something you have to acquire a certain amount of knowledge, which is not social knowledge, but really knowledge about some things, fields, very specific topics, really, that you then put together in order to become an expert. For an artist, this is not the same thing. You shouldn't become this kind of expert by accumulating information. You should become an expert by accumulating something else which is beyond the realm of the spoken word. And there it becomes a bit tricky, because what we're doing it for the reason that we cannot speak about it, really. So it's a bit strange to speak about it anyhow, about the project that I've been doing. And that's one reason why I normally avoid to speak about my projects at all, because I do it for this main reason. But so I think if there's any reason for doing an art school, first of all, change the name, and second is, or find a good name for it, and second is think about what kind of information can be really transferred and what the social value of it is.
Thank you both very much. And actually, we've had presentations from Maya and from here about new models, and we speak about that later. I wanted now maybe to ask Rem that we could start to talk a little bit how it started for you to become necessary or urgent to invent a new school after having done for 10 years this project of Harvard within a bigger school, because we've been talking about it for 2 or 3 years now, but I was wondering what sort of triggered it.
Well, I should say, maybe first of all, the fact that I did the past 8 years kind of decreased my eagerness to be involved in America, and increased my sense that something needed to happen in Europe. But I would also like to kind of dissociate myself a little bit from the word school, because I think that what I think is necessary is kind of really a place where you can think about issues, and whether and not necessarily a place that educates people or that kind of takes responsibility for people to launch a particular career, whatever you call their profession. I think there's a number of urgencies kind of right now that of issues that need to be thought out, and I think what interests me is to set up an organization that recruits intelligence wherever it comes from, and that somehow frames that intelligence in a way that produces results, and I'll say progressive results. And so I dread a little bit the kind of infrastructure that would come from a school. I also think we should declare that we don't want to exist, more than 4 or 5 years, and that our only interest is to clarify and find a number of answers to a number of very painful and difficult issues.
Can we maybe talk a little bit more about Europe? Because it felt from the beginning when we had this conversation actually to do that in Europe, and a couple of months ago I had this conversation with Matthias Agustiniak from MM, and he was saying that he really doesn't really see a place in Europe where he can teach or transmit anything, and that's to do with graphic design or art or architecture, and that he might have to emigrate to the US because he doesn't see a place in Europe. So it doesn't have to do with the fact that something is missing on in Europe, but I think it also has to do obviously with your involvement in Brussels.
Well, it's really a kind of very basic observation. I think that everywhere, it's not only art schools that are kind of in trouble, but European universities kind of in general are all suffering, at least from kind of lack of investment, and in many cases also of lack of purpose or lack of vision. And so there's nothing new to say about it being a crisis. And at the same time, we see everywhere else, whether it's the Middle East, not really that I think that we are thinking so well or that Europe is uniquely capable of addressing certain issues, but I think that there is the threat of an absence more than the threat of an absence.
Well, I mean, we've heard kind of models tonight, and it was a very interesting answer that Pierre mentioned, I think, Nova Scotia as a model, which we somehow had forgotten about, but I think it's important to bring back. I was wondering to which extent, because living in London very often, the AA, where you spend time, is somehow brought back as another model. Could you maybe talk a little bit about if there's anything to learn from that?
The whole idea of models at this point makes me very nervous. I mean, I actually don't understand why we're part of a forum that is called Black Mountain College Model for the 21st Century. I mean, I think we have to be very careful that we're not kind of slightly nostalgic or reactionary. And I think that, particularly at this moment, there is absolutely zero reason to be nostalgic. And because we are certainly confronted with a kind of very tangible urgency, and therefore we have the opportunity to refresh and for some fresh thinking, and even for some new amateurism. And that's what I like about your kind of lecture. It sounds mostly fresh, and I think that kind of in many ways the kind of casualness that you kind of propose. My only question about your thing is, why do you still have teachers? Why do we still have artists kind of standing in front of classes with kind of images? And that was my only question. And why is it so important that Dan Graham turns up? And why...
Because I believe in legacy. And it was very nice that, you know, they stopped something in Nova Scotia and the person stopped it there. And the answer to your question, I think, is the 12 students. Like, the picture we show is like all... sometimes you need some things to survive and to demonstrate you are alive. Mm-hmm. And so we do some open session. But the program, the real program for the school, it doesn't have a picture because it's like it's 12 people in a bar, so it doesn't look nice on screen, and I was trying to fill up the screen. That's why we just have 12. If you have 30, it's lecture 12. Like, the idea is like whoever comes waits as much as the 12. That's the selection base, you know? It's like when we pick 12 people, we don't even know what they do before. It's just people you will love to get stuck in the elevator with. And even if you are, you can be the Grammy, you can be a Nobel Prize, we have a little bit of everything, but everybody works the same, because it's like sometimes, you know, it's like you can balance experience. No, I mean, maybe you need two new to balance a very good, steady one. But the idea is like just a dialogue, you know, it's like no one is teaching, everybody's listening.
With you, with the numbers, I think 12 is excellent, and I agree that more is impossible.
Yeah. Rudolf Arnheim always told me he thinks one can go up to 16 maximum or something, but it's in that sort of range. But it's interesting also, I mean, you mentioned the freshness, and I mean, one thing I experienced totally when I came to Pierre School is this freshness, and also something to do with what Baldessari very often said, is that when there is something happening with art schools, and we need a neologism, so we shouldn't call it schools anymore.
So,
urgent neologism, we can figure it out. I
would call it a seminar, or something like that. I mean, a seminar announces that there is a subject that everyone can think about it, and that it's kind of mutual interaction, and a school still has this kind of hierarchy. So a seminar is for me something that is much more plausible.
A seminar is also interesting because it really was what Pontus Rutten and Daniel Brenn and their friends Sakis and Serge Fauchot did with their institutes in the late 80s, early 90s, out of which a whole generation of artists from Philippe Pareno and Dominique Gonzalez-Ferster grew out. And that was never a school, it was just a seminar. seminar, which happened every now and then in an apartment where Lyota would come and talk to the young artists. And that leads us back to Maya's project. Because I think one of the things, Maya, you haven't talked about yet, which I think would be very interesting, is this idea of your way of involving very directly artists. And I mean, Balesai was saying these seminars, which have been interesting in history, they've very often been driven by artists or architects. They have been sort of almost like artist-run spaces. And you involve artists like Philippe Barreno and Liam Gillick very directly in your process. It would be great to hear a bit about that.
Well, I think this came out of a need, an emergency, because the fact that you don't have a building, but you still want to keep on working, makes it like a nomadic, and I very often use that word inside of the Human Foundation, that we are creating some nomadic think tanks, because we don't have the building. And actually, when I announced that I wanted to create a building in Arles, it was understood like I'm looking for a place to put my foundation in, which is absolutely not the fact. I might be here a little on the wrong panel, although I really love to be here, because I actually have never been thinking in terms of schools. So what Rencola said before is actually really, I've never been thinking about this. We have tried to address the questions of artist residences in a place which is not a big city, and about, instead of collection or showing collection, archiving, like everybody's talking about this recently, but it's absolutely important for my generation at least, and I don't think it comes out of nostalgia. It really is to document and to keep on going. So I am maybe looking for a way to have the artists come and visit this place as being residents, and then in seminars it would end up in being education for a new generation, if possible. But as you all saw, there is a long way to go for us, and so on the way we are going to continue doing the seminars or the think tanks. The rest is more a political thing with France, Southern France, and everybody getting involved, and this is why I am insecure sometimes to talk about it, because there is a lot of people involved, and a lot of between the architects and between the local politics, between the national politics, between the international community. So, for the time being, we do seminars, and we hope that it is a way to go for the next 3, 4, 5 years, and the more interesting people, not the more, but we are going to define what we really want, and I hope this can make a tiny difference for generation which is younger than mine.
Great, thank you all very much. I think we can open it now to the floor if there are any urgent questions to our speakers. I see a question here.
Yeah, I'm just wondering why Black Mountain College as the point of beginning the conversation, or not Gramsci, or not something more contemporary like Lydia Lab, or why that as a model for the organization.
Yeah, the idea was really just to use, I mean, whenever we sort of ask what could be an inspiration for a type of seminars now, that was somehow mentioned, but it was more or less 5 minutes before the program went to print. And anyway, I'm really glad we got rid of the notion of school, because what Cedric Price always said, whenever we were on a panel of the city, he said we must get rid of the notion of the city and invent the neologism. So it's seminars. Are there any other questions?
Getting something out of it, but also producing something. I think the producing reality, which is a very critical thing for me. Also.
Yes, and I mean, it had to do a lot with the fact that, I mean, we produce, been on too many panels where we represent. we no longer want to do this because it doesn't produce anything interesting for us nor for the participants. So we felt we had this vague intuition, which has been going on now for quite some time with REM, that it could be relevant and urgent to invent a new type of knowledge structure, and let's call it a seminar, and to do that in Brussels. And we have not really made major progress lately, so we felt it could be interesting in Munich to gather a group and obviously discuss how we could make steps forward. And we felt particularly important to discuss also with artists who haven't been involved in any kind of teaching activity as of lately, and somehow address that as well. So it's really the production of reality pen. I mean, I've always believed, I mean, started from the outset of when we worked with Christa Ma in 95 for the Academy of the Third Millennium, which was the predecessor to DLD, or the structure before. Was extremely interesting when we did our brain. Actually, that event wasn't really a conference, it was an anti-conference, and it produced a lot of reality. I mean, lots of exhibitions, books, and things have come out of that. So it's production of reality as a principle. Are there any other? Yeah, there's two questions.
Speak about what I did there, but it was very interesting for me to hear that they all said this
it was the most incredible experience of their life to live together with this. At the end, there were only 9 people left, because some obviously dropped out. But to live together with these other people that they never really saw before in their life, through this incredible intense experience, and they're all still very much connected to each other. So they said this was the best art school experience that they ever had in their life. Are there any other questions for our speaker? I see a question here.
Okay, I've observed that most of you have not had a proper art education. You all come from a different background, but then develop into design and art. So how do you see that affecting, you know, artists in the future? Like, without an art background.
Hello? I don't think Leonardo ever went to art school, no? Like, you don't need an art school to be
exactly, that's my point.
I think everybody is.
Your point is, given the fact that none of you went to art school, are you the right people to talk about art school?
Because we went to art school.
I understand.
My class, which is the opposite of the art school, agricultural sciences. There's also some kind of culture in the world, but it's absolutely the opposite of the art school. And that's my personal belief. If you want to become an artist, do the opposite, learn the other way around, and not go there. And get, I mean, you still have to know a lot about it, but just do it on your proper exercise with your friends and everything. But you don't have to go to the so-called art school. So I think I went to the opposite art school, but it's still an art school.
Maybe that leads us also, in what Carsten was saying, leads us also back to the reason why we kind of maybe use the title of the Black Mountain College even then to get rid of it. But it has somehow to do, I mean, I had a long conversation with John Chamberlain about these experiments which had really happened at Black Mountain College, which were not, they were actually not even seminars, they were just more doing something together with each other, and somehow Buckminster Fuller. It's also something, actually both Carl André and John Chamberlain told me, it's a very, very interesting way. For example, Buckminster Fuller met Kenneth Nelson, and they started to build together with the students and the participants, geodesic domes. And so it was really not even seminars, it was more experiences, and that maybe was one of the reasons we used that as a title. We've got also by email arrived the questions, actually, of Marissa Mayo, whose panel either still goes on upstairs, or maybe it ended. Was sending us these questions, I can ask them, but before that I want to check if there are any other urgent questions for our panelists from the floor. Otherwise, we move on to concluding maybe with Marissa's question, who was actually writing me the following email. At the same time as our panel, the other hall is discussing software. As a crossover, they have a question for us. In the spirit of this idea of new seminars, what can software do to make education more dynamic, more personal, and more conductive to creative pursuits like yours? Or she says, if that won't work, an alternate question, how is software touching and changing each of your disciplines? How will technology change what you do? These are the questions from Marissa Meyer. Does anybody want to? It's a great conclusion.